Toyota shocked the world with a brand new VA hydrogen combustion engine that could destroy the EV industry and keep the internal combustion engine alive. This one actually is kind of interesting because unlike the Mirai that has a fuel cell that converts hydrogen into electricity and powers an electric motor, this thing is an internal combustion engine. Like we mentioned, V8, that means four cylinders on either side and all the combustion bits and glory. So all the fury and sounds of a gas car without the batteries or emissions sound too good to be true? Well, Toyota doesn't think so. So today let's talk about the hydrogen combustion engine and if they can really challenge battery EVs for the future of mobility. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. We've covered hydrogen several times on this channel and for good reason. It's the most abundant element in the universe. It's the most energy dense fuel we know behind nuclear fuels. And it doesn't produce any carbon emissions when burned or used to make electricity. This is why many herald hydrogen as the energy storage solution for the future and is part of the reason why Japan is hell-bent on developing its hydrogen economy. But for every hydrogen lover, you'll find a hater because hydrogen is plagued with as many limitations as it offers benefits. All of which apply to Toyota's new venture. Toyota's hydrogen combustion engine is a normal internal combustion engine modified to work with hydrogen. It has a couple of reinforcements like stronger connecting rods, harder valves and valve seats, and gas fuel injectors. But apart from that, it looks and works almost exactly like a normal gasoline ICE. A hydrogen fuel air mixture is burned inside a cylinder moving a piston. The piston moves a crankshaft that spins, ultimately powering the vehicle. The engine was actually designed and developed by Toyota in collaboration with Yamaha, who worked on it for 5 years. It was unveiled in November 2021, and it's a 5.0-liter V8 based on the Lexus RCF coupe engine. This is an engine for muscle car lovers. It pumps out an impressive 450 horsepower at 6,800 RPM and 398 foot-pounds of torque, almost identical to the 2023 Ford Mustang GT engine. It also features an awesome 8-in-1 top-mount exhaust manifold that produces an amazing high-frequency sound profile. The engine also offers a smooth and responsive driving experience, all of it with almost zero carbon emissions. Okay, I know what you're thinking. Almost zero emissions? There's no carbon in hydrogen. I know, and we'll get back to that here in a minute. Overall, hydrogen combustion engines sound pretty promising. Although it made headlines in 2021, this isn't the first hydrogen ICE, not even by Toyota. BMW produced the 750 HL in 2002 and the Hydrogen 7 Series in 2005, but then scrapped both. Toyota also made a couple of H2 ICE prototypes in 2021, including a modified GR Yaris H2 concept car. It sported a turbocharged 1.6-liter three-cylinder engine and came in fourth in its category in the Super Taikyu Series in 2021. Not bad. But hydrogen combustion never became mainstream. You see, in the quest for cleaner and more sustainable transportation, there are several alternative powertrain technologies competing for attention. The most important ones are battery EVs. Hydrogen fuel cell powered vehicles, or FCEVs, and hydrogen combustion vehicles, or H2 ICEs. Who wins boils down to the pros and cons of each. Let's start by comparing hydrogen cars in general with EVs, starting with their pros. The key advantage to hydrogen cars over EVs is that you don't have to wait 30 minutes or several hours to charge a hydrogen car. You can fill up a 142-liter tank in under 5 minutes, whereas a battery pack with a similar range would easily take around 30 minutes or so, at least today. Range anxiety is a known issue that holds many people back from adopting EVs. I know I felt it before I got my first Tesla. That's something you don't usually have to worry about with a hydrogen car, since hydrogen has a 33.6 kilowatt hours per kilogram energy density, which is almost 70 times higher than the current record-breaking holder for batteries by Amperes Technologies at 500 watt hours per kilogram. This means that you can pack a lot more range in a hydrogen tank than in a battery of the same weight. That said, you may still suffer from range anxiety with a hydrogen car, since hydrogen fueling stations are almost non-existent. In the US, you'll only find them in California and Hawaii, really. So no road trips down Route 66 in a hydrogen car, at least for now. Also, once you get used to your EV's range, the anxiety really does wear off, and that's really overstated. Before we get into that, let's talk about our sponsor this week, Delete Me. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that will remove your personal information that's being sold online. Delete Me's privacy experts remove you from Google and 100-plus data brokers all year long. Get a privacy report in 7 days. Remove all your personal information like phone and address. monitor sites, and repeat removal as needed, and users can even make custom removal requests. I've been a member now for almost 6 months, and I just got my second quarterly report. Staying private online is an ongoing battle. Just look at all the places DeleteMe has removed my data and where it's in progress. Truly amazing, and something none of us spend nearly enough time thinking about. With DeleteMe, you don't have to. Let their team of experts scour the web and keep your personally identifiable information private. So stay a step ahead of your privacy online and save 20% on all plans with code Ricky with DeleteMe. Links in description. Huge thanks to DeleteMe and you for supporting the show. Another key aspect of H2 ICEs is that their range isn't heavily impacted by ambient temperature. So if your car has a 400-mile range, it'll be more or less 400 miles in winter or summer. A Tesla Model 3 Performance, on the other hand, will see its range roughly half, depending on how cold it is, from 400 miles to 200 miles in the same conditions, which can be a problem for particularly cold days. A key trait of hydrogen vehicles is that the hydrogen combustion process itself produces no CO2 emissions, making them a more environmentally friendly option than traditional gasoline engines. But there's a catch. The engine overall does emit a small amount of carbon into the atmosphere, mainly from lubricant seeping into the combustion chamber. It also produces other pollutants I'll mention when we cover the cons. This doesn't happen with EVs or even fuel cell EVs. Another benefit of the combustion hydrogen engine is that it requires a lot less rare earth materials. For example, in EVs, you need nickel, lithium. Some still use cobalt. Also, in fuel cell EVs, you need platinum as a catalyst for the H2 and oxygen reaction. A lot of that stuff is simplified dramatically in the case of a combustion hydrogen engine. So real quick, let's break this down. There's the energy storage and then the powertrain system. In the case of gasoline, gasoline is the energy storage and an internal combustion engine is the powertrain, the part that converts that fuel and moves you forward. In the case of battery electric cars, you have batteries for the energy storage and electric motors. In the case of hydrogen fuel cells, you have hydrogen fuel as the storage and you have a fuel cell that produces electricity and electric motor still. Now this is hydrogen as an energy storage medium, but hydrogen combustion engines as the powertrain. No electronics and no electric motors at play. That's the fundamental difference here. Another key advantage is that hydrogen combustion engines are much cheaper upfront than battery EVs, and they're way cheaper than hydrogen fuel cell vehicles. For example, the average price of a Tesla Model 3 Performance with a 300-mile battery pack costs around $53,000, while the Honda Clarity fuel cell starts at $59,000. And the Toyota Mirai fuel cell costs around $50,000 to $66,000. A H2 ICE is expected to cost around $30,000 to $40,000. This could technically mean that hydrogen combustion cars are a more accessible option for most consumers, at least for now. But for some, EVs are missing a key part of the driving experience, which is the sound and feel of an internal combustion engine revving up to multiple thousand RPMs and all the sound and fury. Even though they're not very efficient, hydrogen combustion engines work best when operated under heavy load. This gives H2 ICEs an edge over fuel cell cars and EVs in applications like heavy machinery and trucks. Another thing about hydrogen that tends to be overlooked is that the fact that hydrogen stations work just like regular gasoline stations, only with more specialized and expensive equipment. They can get the hydrogen via pipes or trucks, just like normal gas stations, or they could even generate it on site via renewable sources. You can make as many stations as wanted based on your budget. So it's a scalable solution. So those are some pros, and I got through that list, but don't think that I'm an advocate for it just yet. As in all things in engineering, hydrogen engines have major trade-offs. And in this case, there's plenty of them. Hydrogen ICE's biggest drawback is efficiency. And it starts with the fuel source. Hydrogen is clingy, so you have to spend lots of energy prying it apart from other elements before you can even use it. There are many ways to make hydrogen, but in the best cases, you lose around 10% of the energy you put in to produce it. But you need to compress or liquefy it to store it, and that also uses energy. Hydrogen compression efficiency is around 55 to 80%. And at the end, you have to turn hydrogen back into energy by burning it in the engine, which is only about 40 to 50% efficient, losing the rest as heat. Remember earlier when I mentioned that hydrogen combustion engines don't suffer as much of a range penalty when it's cold out? Well, that's why. 50% of the energy is wasted as heat. So that means all you have to do is pipe that heat into the cabin for heating. You don't need to run any other extra heaters. Whereas battery EVs and fuel cells are so efficient, they produce so little heat, you have to actually produce the heat. In the end, you get an overall efficiency of 36% and the very best cases. If you compare that in the US to a lithium-ion battery, that's almost 100% efficient. In the end, you get an overall efficiency of 36% in the very best case. If you compare that to a lithium-ion battery round trip, which is almost 80%, 85% efficient, that means that you get almost 3 times as much energy out of a battery as you do out of the same amount of hydrogen using a combustion engine. EVs are the clear winners here by a long shot, and this is probably nothing new. This is why EVs are being invested into so much. Fuel cells are also much more efficient than ICEs, ranging from 60 to 87% for a maximum total efficiency of 63%, almost twice that of the hydrogen combustion engine. That said, with adequate maintenance, the internal combustion efficiency doesn't really degrade significantly over time, and if it does, it can be repaired with an engine overhaul. Whereas battery capacity degrades irreversibly, and so does fuel cell efficiency. In the US, there's currently a very limited network of hydrogen refueling stations in California and Hawaii. That's it. This is a huge chicken or the egg problem, because until there's more hydrogen cars, who's going to build hydrogen stations that aren't going to get used? And until there's more hydrogen stations, who's going to buy the hydrogen car? It's one of those things where one company has to just jump out and build it, like what Tesla did with charging and batteries. Remember when I told you the hydrogen combustion engines are almost emission-free? Well, that's because they emit NOxes, or nitrous oxides. You see, whenever there's air temperature above 1371 degrees Celsius, there's going to be NOx formation. And H2 burns at 2182 degrees Celsius. So it would be a myth to say the hydrogen engines only produce water vapor as a byproduct. Tailpipe emissions include traces of carbon gases from the lubricants and different nitrogen oxides, making these engines unsuitable for indoor use. The cost of hydrogen fuel can be higher than traditional petrol, depending on the production method and location. Producing, storing, and transporting hydrogen can be complex and energy intensive, potentially offsetting some of the environmental benefits of hydrogen combustion engines. Also, depending on how we produce it, hydrogen may end up being dirtier than fossil fuels. For it to make sense, we need to ensure that we're using clean hydrogen made from renewable sources like sun and wind, green hydrogen, or other technologies. Japan is famous for its red hydrogen initiative to produce hydrogen gas through a thermochemical process that uses waste heat from high-temperature nuclear reactors. We made a video about this you can check out here. Traditional ICEs have many moving parts and require regular oil changes and replacements due to wear and tear. Hydrogen internal combustion engines have even higher maintenance costs since the H2 tanks and injection systems are even more complex. Consequently, maintenance and repair costs for an EV are about 40% cheaper than for a hydrogen combustion engine car. One of the biggest concerns most people have regarding hydrogen cars is the thought of a Hindenburg-style explosion if they were ever in a crash, or if there's a leak in the hydrogen tank in the garage. Hydrogen is one of the smallest gases around, and it does leak out of almost every container. But rest assured, there's almost no risk to it. Hydrogen tanks are armored, high-pressure vessels designed to withstand even the toughest crash. There are dozens of videos of crash tests involving the Hydrogen Mirai, which uses the same type of hydrogen tanks that the new H2 ICEs would use. Also, hydrogen has a much higher self-ignite temperature than most other fuels, including gasoline and natural gas, making it harder to ignite and explode. Plus, it's a light gas that tends to rise in the atmosphere, unlike gasoline vapor, which accumulates near the ground. So the risk is actually less than with a gasoline car. Also, if you've seen these videos from Toyota, they've done shot tests where they'll fire rounds into a hydrogen tank, and these systems are built with pressure relief valves that can blow off the hydrogen up into the atmosphere and other venting systems. So these things are well thought out and fairly safe. So, okay, that's in the car situation. What if there's a leak in the tank while I'm parked in my garage? Am I gonna blow up? Not likely. Leakage rates for normal tanks at higher than nominal pressures, we're talking like 10,000 PSI and above, is only about 2.3% annually. A team of researchers locked up a Toyota Mirai with a full 122-liter tank of hydrogen at 10,000 PSI in a small sealed container and measured hydrogen leak to be between 2.14 and 6.43 milliliters of hydrogen per minute for a parked car. It would take a little over a month for hydrogen to concentrate to reach a dangerous threshold of 1% of air by volume in a completely sealed and tiny garage. At the end of the day, the reason why we made this video is because this is a different approach to hydrogen. We've always seen hydrogen electric cars, but this is a hydrogen combustion car. But as we've laid out, it has all the same problems of traditional hydrogen cars, which is really low efficiency and there's not much in the way of a charge network. why companies like Toyota continue to invest in these sorts of things is a bit of a head-scratcher, especially because they were so quick to make the Prius, and they had wild success, and they realized very early on that if you want to make a car more efficient, add more electricity to it. Now, I know securing a battery supply chain and building battery EVs is no small feat, but we've seen a huge resurgence, and it's hard to imagine exactly why this makes sense. In a lot of ways, you're keeping all the negatives of an internal combustion engine, all the camshafts and springs and seals and all the high-pressure igniters and everything else, while not retaining any of the benefits of electric cars. You don't have instant torque with a hydrogen internal combustion engine car, by the way, not like you do with a battery EV. So all the benefits of EVs, not there. All the baggage of internal combustion, very much there. It's a hard thing to understand. And why I think Toyota's kind of losing their way a bit with this investment. One thing about Toyota you can tell a lot about is how they partner with companies to do things they don't really believe in. I'll give you some examples. The first is the Toyota AE86 or the Subaru BRZ. That was a joint venture with Subaru because they didn't really believe that they'd have enough sales to justify building a car and doing all the research and development costs themselves. Another example, Toyota Supra, which they partner with BMW. The car is largely a BMW Z4 with a little bit of a different body shape, but the engine is BMW and so is everything else. When Toyota really believes in something, they do it themselves. And when they don't, they do this partnership deal, like with Yamaha for this engine, for example. What the future of this engine really holds is hard to say, but to think that this is going to be some kind of a magic bullet, it is anything but. But I'd love to know what you think. Let us know in the comments if you think this is a car design or technology that you would be interested in. And if you think this is wild, you got to watch this video next.